Hello guys, welcome to another session as continuation of the diadem. We'll discuss about jejunum and ileum in today's session, right? The small bowel proper extends from the duodeno-jejunal flexor to the ileocecal junction. So you have already known what is duodeno-jejunal flexure and what is ileocecal junction, right? It supports 2/5, forms the jejunum, and lower 3/5 forms the ileum, right? However, there is no definite line of demarcation. We have already discussed this in the previous session. There is no clear cut demarcation between jejunum and ileum. The jejunum and ileum are suspended from the posterior abdominal wall by a large fold of peritoneum called mesentery of the small intestine, right? Hence, the small intestine enjoys a considerable mobility. See, so from here all the way to here is called small intestine, right? But from here to here is called as small bowel. Okay, so upper 2/5 and lower 3/5, upper 2/5 is called as jejunum and lower 3/5 is called as ileum, right? This junction is called as ileocecal junction, and this junction is called as duodeno-jejunal flex, right? You see, so this is nearly 6 meters in length, right? Small intestine is 6 meters in length. So these are the loops. The proximal part is jejunum and the distal part is ileum. That is, immediately after the duodenum comes the jejunum, right? And the distal part is ileum, right? And this is the mesentery. You have already seen this in the mesentery class, right? Mesentery of the small intestine, right? So all of these folds are mesenteric folds, right? Approximately 30 times the mesenteric folds are 30 times higher at the end of intestinal end than it attachments at the abdominal wall, right? So that many folds you can observe. Coming to the jejunum has an external diameter of 4 centimeters and an internal diameter of 3 centimeters. Thicker wall than ileum. Remember that jejunum is thicker and richer in arterial blood supply, right? The plicae circularis are most pronounced in the proximal jejunum, where they are most numerous and deeper than elsewhere in the small bowel. So plicae circularis are most prominent in the proximal jejunum. Remember these things. They frequently branch around the lumen and may appear to be stacked on top of each other, giving the jejunum a characteristic appearance during single contrast radiography, CT and MR enterography. Okay, this branching of plicae circularis, right, gives velvety appearance or feathery, right? So these are the circular folds the case circular is, right? And you see, if you observe on the left panel, okay, J stands for jejunum. You see, all of these appearing as velvety or wool-like structure, like, right? So that is like a circularis, right? You see, you can also see, right? PC means pleca circularis. Okay, this velvet appearance is also partly because of the villi. In the supine position, the jejunum usually occupies the upper left infracolic compartment extending down to the umbilical region. You can see that. See? So, this one is ileum, right? In the supine position, upper left infracolic, right? The first one or two loops are often occupy a recess between left part of the transverse mesocolon and the left kidney. On supine radiological examination, the jejunal loops are characteristically situated in the upper abdomen to the left of the midline, whereas the ileal loops tend to lie in the lower right part of the abdominal pelvis, right? So upper left is jejunum, lower right part is ileum. The distribution can be reversed in small bowel obstruction. So if the bowel is obstructed, so this left and right distribution will be disturbed due to rotation of the dilated bowel around the mesenteric attachment, right? So the obstructed bowel become rotated. Coming to the ileum, ileum has a median external diameter of 3 centimeters, that is less than jejunum, right? An internal diameter of 2.5 centimeters and tends to have a thinner wall, right? The plica circularis become progressively less obvious. In the distal ileum, they tend to be single and flatter. The mucosa of the terminal ileum, immediately proximal to the ileocecal junction, may appear almost flat at endoscopy, although the villi can be seen when viewed close up and at capsule endoscopy. So progressively it becomes the circularis, plica circularis becomes flattened, 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 and at the terminal ileum, it's almost flat, right? In the supine position, the ileum lies mainly in the hypogastric and in the right iliac fossa. The terminal ileum frequently lies in the pelvis, from where it ascends over the right psoas major and right iliac vessels to end by opening at the ileocecal junction in the right iliac fossa. So what you have to remember is jejunal ileum is very mobile, right? Coming to the microstructure, the small intestine consists of 4 layers, right? From within outwards, mucosa, submucosa, muscle layer, and serosa. Coming to the mucosa, innermost layer, it has 3 relevant features, right? Larger surface area. For digestion and absorption, these are the functions of the small bowel, jejunum and ileum. The surface area of the mucous membrane is enormously increased by plica circularis, villi, and microvilli. So these three things, plica circularis, villi, and microvilli, increases the surface area, okay, almost 30-fold. Plica circularis are valves of Kerkring. These are the circular folds which are permanent and are not obliterated by distension, okay. Villi. The surface of circular folds is thrown into small 0.5 mm to or less in length finger-like projection called villi, right? And microvilli, the surface of epithelium covering The villi presents microvilli. So villi has microvilli or striated bod. The total surface area of mucosa of the small intestine is about 200 square meters. The entire epithelial lining of the small intestine is replaced in every 2 to 4 days. Right? That is, and the second feature is intestinal glands or crypts of Leberkuhn. In between the bases of villi, the epithelium is invaginated, right, in the lamina propria to form the intestinal glands. They secrete digestive enzymes and mucus. Coming to the third feature, lymphatic follicles. The lamina propria of the mucous membrane contains two types of lymphatic follicles: solitary lymphatic follicles and aggregated lymphatic follicles. Solitary lymph follicles are 1 to 2 mm in diameter and are distributed throughout the length of the small intestine, right? Whereas aggregated lymph follicles, they form circular or oval patches called pear patches. So these solitary lymph follicles, right, aggregate at some places called as pear patches, right? Each pear patches consists of 5 to 260 solitary lymph follicles, and its length varies from 2 to 10 centimeters. They are present lengthwise along the anti-mesenteric border. Pear patches are small, circular, fewer in the distal part of the jejunum, and large, oval, and numerous in ileum, particularly in its distal part. So in jejunum, they are smaller, circular, and fewer, whereas in ileum, they are larger, oval, and numerous. In the distal part of the ileum, where pear patches are much larger and most numerous, may extend in the submucosa after breaking the muscularis mucosa. Right. Coming to the submucosal layer, it is made up of loose areolar tissue and contains blood vessels, lymph vessels, and nerve plexus, Meissner's plexus. Muscular layer, it is made up of outer longitudinal and inner circular layers of smooth muscle, Auerbach, right? Auerbach plexus of nose is present between these two layers, right? I think you have already learned these plexus in your physiology. Coming to the serosa, is formed by visceral peritoneum. So in the internal features, so this is the proximal jejunum, has numerous plicae circularis, right? In the proximal ileum, and in the distal ileum, there are numerous pear patches, right? You see, these are the plicae circularis, and this one is pear patch, and these are invaginations of crypts of Leberkuhn. Circular folds, it's a representative diagram. You see, on the right panel, I am reading a lower power micrograph showing several circular folds, arrows, right? Arrows. In the wall of ileum, the folds are covered with villi V. So these are the villi, right? So these are the villi, and this is the circular fold, plicae circularis and villi projecting into the lumen, and the submucosa extends. This is the submucosa, loose areolar tissue extends to the core of each fold. Circular, innermost and longitudinal smooth muscles layers form the underlying muscularis externa. This is muscularis externa. Large masses of lymphoid tissue, pear patches, lie in the mucosa, right? So these are the crypts of Leberkuhn invagination, and this is villi, right? This is the structure of LI actually. So this is how they absorb, right? Coming to the differences between jejunum and ileum. While there is no clear boundary between jejunum and ileum, there are general anatomical differences between these two regions. The wall of the jejunum is thicker and more vascular, has a great number of prominent plicae circularis and contains less lymphoid tissue than ileum. Okay, lymphoid tissue is less, remaining things are more. There are also differences between mesenteric vessels in the jejunum and ileum. The jejunal mesentery measured from superior mesenteric artery to mesenteric border of the bowel is shorter than the ileal mesentery, and the jejunal arteries are slightly larger than their ileal counterparts. Jejunum typically contains 1 to 3 tiers of vascular arcades, whereas ileum has 2 to 6 tiers of arcades. We'll see that more. The arteriae rectae in the ileum are more numerous, shorter and narrower than in the jejunum. See, A is jejunum and B is ileum. See, the mesentery itself is thicker in the jejunum, whereas mesentery is thinner in ileum. And you see, there are numerous plicae circularis, and there is less prominent plicae circularis, and but numerous pair patches. There are no pair patches here, like that. We already gone through this. So this is the proximal jejunum A, and this is distal jejunum. You see, proximal jejunum has more prominent plicae circularis, right? And CA is proximal ileum, and this is terminal ileum. You see, you can clearly observe the villi here, right? Villi. Here also there are villi. This is the specimens of the jejunum and ileum from cadaver where the superior mesenteric artery was injected with the red colored gelatin before fixation. Subsequently, the specimens were dehydrated and then cleared in benzene followed by methyl salicylate. The largest vessel present are jejunal and ileal branch of the superior mesenteric artery, right? Successive anastomotic arterial arcades. So A is jejunum and B is ileum. You see, there are only 1 to 3 arcades, right? Here it is 1, but here 1, 2, 3, right? So these are the arteria rectae or vasa rectae, arteria rectae. So jejunum has only 1 to 3, whereas ileum has 2 to 6. Okay, so this is the real cadaveric arterial septum, photograph of arterial septum. Isn't it spectacular? So this is jejunum and this is ileum. See, the arterial arcades, more arterial arcades in ileum, less arterial arcades in this is direct vasa recta supplying the bowel, right? This is the differences, right? Lumen has more wider and narrow. Villi, paired branches, mesentery, arterial arcades, right? See, this is the differences in different layers of the intestine. This is esophagus, alimentary canal. This is esophagus, stomach, duodenum, jejunum, ileum, and colon. Right? So in jejunum there are more villi, right? More villi, and here there are more villi. Along with that, there are patches also, lymphoid tissue, right? Coming to the arterial supply. The jejunum and ileum are supplied by jejunal and ileal branches of superior mesenteric artery. Right? So, superior mesenteric artery. They arise from the left side of the superior mesenteric artery and enter the mesentery to reach the intestine. If you remember the previous session, mesentery itself contains blood vessels. Right? So, it helps in transmission of blood vessels. The terminal part of the ileum is supplied by ileal branches of the ileocolic branch of superior mesenteric artery. As soon as they enter the mesentery, they break up into smaller branches which anastomose with each other to form a series of arterial arcades, which are more complex in the ileum than in the jejunum. From the convexities of terminal arcade, small parallel straight vessels called vasa recta arise and pass to the mesenteric border of the gut to be distributed alternatively to the opposite surfaces of the small intestine. The anastomosis between vasa recta is poor. You have already seen this. So this is the arterial arcade, more complex in ileum, less complex in jejunum. This is arterial arcade and this is vasa recta or arterial arcade. The superior mesenteric artery usually gives off inferior pancreaticoduodenal, middle colic, right colic, ileocolic branches from its right side and jejunal and ileal branches from its left side. Okay, remember those things. Its jejunal and ileal branches from vascular arcades within the small bowel mesentery. The last of these arcades form an irregular and incomplete marginal artery, right, of the small intestine. So the last of these arcades, right? Straight arteries, arteria recta, given off from the most distal arcades and passed directly to the small intestine. So you see, this is the superior mesenteric artery. And these are its branches. These are the jejunal branches and these are the ileal branches. Whereas, you see inferior pancreaticoduodenal artery, this one. And this one is middle colic artery, right colic artery, ileocolic artery, right? Jejunal branches. Usually 4 to 6 jejunal branches arise from left side of the upper portion of the superior mesenteric artery. Distributed the jejunum via 1 to 3 tiers of arterial arcades, most distal of which gives rise to straight arteries. Okay. The latter run almost parallel in the mesentery before being distributed alternatively to either side of the small bowel, forming 2 distinct leaves of vessels, right? Within the mesentery, separated by a relatively avascular plane. That means, in the mesentery, they travel like this, the branches, before they are supplying bowel. So this forms as a leaf-like pattern, right? This vascular arrangement allows a dilated segment of small bowel to be bisected longitudinally and tubularized to double its length, a potentially useful technique to achieve small bowel lengthening in short bowel syndrome. Right, because of this pattern. you see, these are the jejunal branches, right? So within the mesentery, they are running parallel and forming a leaf-like structure, right? Translucent area means devoid of fat. So arcades and vasarrector. Coming to the ileal branches, they are numerous 8 to 12 and slightly smaller in caliber than jejunal branches. They arise from the left and anterior aspects of the superior mesenteric artery. Branches form between 2 to 6 arcades before giving rise to multiple straight arteries that run directly to the ileal wall. They are shorter, thinner than the jejunal counterparts, particularly in the distal ileum, and do not form such distinct parallel leaves of vessels. So that leaf pattern is present in jejunum but less prominent in ileum. The terminal ileal arcades are supplied by ileal branch of iliacolic artery and the last ileal branch of the superior mesenteric artery. Few other vessels connect the iliacolic and superior mesenteric territories, which makes surgical dissection of the iliacolic artery up to its origin relatively simple, right? So this is ileal branches. So this is a superior mesenteric artery and these branches. A digital subtraction of angiogram. So this is angiogram and this is CT angiogram. So this is superior mesenteric artery and these are the branches. You see, these are the jejunal branches and these are the iliac branches, right? Here also in the CT, these are the jejunal branches and these are the iliac branches, right? So this is mesentery, right? So superior mesenteric artery giving rise to jejunal branches and ileal branches, right? This is same jejunal arteries. These are all jejunal branches and these are all ileal branches. Right, this one being superior mesenteric artery. Right, the veins correspond to the branches of superior mesenteric artery and drain into portal vein, carry the products of protein and carbohydrates to the liver. So same veins also same names as the arteries, right? Superior mesenteric vein leading to the portal vein, right? Again, superior mesenteric vein and its branches. So this one is superior mesenteric vein, right? This one, this is portal vein. So jejunal vein, ileal vein. This is jejunal vein, and this one being ileal vein. Lymph vessels from the small intestine pass through a large number of mesenteric nodes, right? Finally drain into superior mesenteric nodes present around the superior mesenteric artery. Lymphatics of the small intestine have a circular course in its wall. The circular tubercular ulcers and subsequent strictures in the small intestine are due to involvement of these lymphatics in tuberculosis, right? Now supply. It has both extrinsic and intrinsic nerve supply. Intrinsic means Auerbach's plexus and Meissner's plexus. Extrinsic means sympathetic and parasympathetic. Sympathetic is from T10 to T11 and parasympathetic is from vagus through celiac and superior mesenteric plexus. right? So through lumbar splanchnic nerves, okay, and superior mesenteric plexus. Superior mesenteric plexus, right? Intrinsic innervation, you have extensively read it in your physiology, but this is a cursory note on intrinsic innervation, right? So this is my enteric plexus. This one being mesenteric plexus. Right. Coming to the anatomical applied anatomy, Meckel's diverticulum or ileal diverticulum. It is the persistent proximal part of embryonic vital intestinal duct. Right. Persistent vital intestinal duct. It is present in 2% of subjects and usually 2 inches long, situated about 2 feet proximal to the ileocecal junction. These are very important points. 2%, 2 inches, 2 feet, right? More common in men. Caliber and structure of its wall are similar to that of ileum. Normally it is very asymptomatic, but when symptoms occurs, it may cause intestinal obstruction, right? When inflamed, it mimics acute appendicitis. So this persistent vital intestinal duct is Meckel's diverticulum, right? This one is Meckel's diverticulum with ectopic mucosa. Typhoid and tubercular ulcers. Pear patches may felt through the anti-mesenteric border of ileum. They may ulcerate in typhoid fever, forming characteristic vertically oriented, right, oval ulcers, which may sometimes perforate. For this reason, patients suffering from typhoid fever are given non-spicy soft diets. After healing, the typhoid ulcer do not cause intestinal obstruction like tubercular ulcers. Tubercular ulcers are circularly placed, right? Circular ulcers, not like this, but like this. Hence, after healing, they often cause constriction of the lumen by fibrous tissue, leading to intestinal obstruction, right? Jejunostomy and ileostomy. In clinical practice, a stoma is a surgically created opening from a hollow viscus to the skin, classified according to its location. Right? Stoma means opening. An intestinal stoma may be either an end stoma, in which only the proximal and divided bowel is anastomosed to the skin, or a loop stoma, in which both proximal and distal ends of the bowels are exteriorized on the surface. So, end stoma and loop stoma. The output of jejunostomy is greater than that of an ileostomy and more likely to result in excessive fluid, electrolyte, and nutrient losses. So, this is a temporary loop ileostomy, right? Short bowel syndrome. Short bowel syndrome is a short bowel syndrome means a physiological result from surgical resection, congenital deficiency or disease associated loss of absorption. So this is a physiological or function related disorder, right? So that means the absorptive capacity of the small intestine is decreased, deficient, right? Inability to maintain protein, energy, fluid and electrolyte or micronutrient balances when on a conventionally accepted normal diet. So left untreated, if you don't treat this, short bowel syndrome leads to dehydration, malnutrition and weight loss because there is functional deficiency in jejunum and ileum, right? So they don't reabsorb all these water, nutrients, protein and all, right? So that is short bowel syndrome. So whenever the intestine fails, okay, in the presence of intestinal failure, there is total intestinal replacement, right? So this is duodenum and jejunum, ileum, jejunum and ileum, right? Coming to the vasculature, so this is superior mesenteric artery with its branches, right? If we, so we will hide ileum and see the, hide jejunum and see different branches, right? So these are the jejunal branches, right? And if you hide ileum, you'll see. So the main branches, right? Right colic, middle colic, right ileocolic, right? So this one being the superior mesenteric artery and left side are iliojejunal branches, right side gives rise to colic branches, right? Okay, and veins are also same names as arteries and same course as arteries. Superior mesenteric vein, this one is, and these are ileal branches, tributaries, right? So these drain to superior mesenteric vein and they drain to portal vein. So this one is portal vein, right? And see, this electrostructure is inferior mesenteric lymph nodes, right? And these are superior mesenteric lymph nodes. They lead to the mesenteric lymph nodes, okay? So this is the total and if you hide any, this is jejunum. If we had, so you can clearly see nose also, right? Superior mesenteric plexus, that is selector structure, is this one, right? This one is superior mesenteric plexus, right? So that is jejunum and ileum. Right. If you have any doubts, let me know.